Kuno doesn't care. That's gonna be the answer there. But you never know, maybe we'll get something out of it.
Kuno's like Kuno's dad! Kuno doesn't give a fuck about anything!
I know you took the locusts from the traps the cryptozoologist set up. Yeah, he says slowly, meeting your gaze with sullen defiance. Kuno took the bugs, so what? Inland Empire says, so it wasn't the phasmid. A wave of disappointment washes over you. You say you don't give a crap about bugs, then you go and build a whole bug town. It's not bug town, it's a city of locusts, he says, enunciating every syllable. Locusts aren't just bug crap, they come out of the sky like a shadow. Stuff descends. Stop! She wails from behind the fence, then buries her face in her hands. Locusts coming down like a shadow. This must be the Night City he mentioned when you asked him where he's been. So that, in there, is Night City? Yeah, Locust City. City of Rage. City of Lights. Conceptualization says there's a tug of war over the name of his fantastical city. It's almost too big for his imagination. The girl forces herself to watch again, the corners of her eyes twitching from discomfort. City of Rage sounds like a cool place. Kuno, the pig wants to help you, she moans. That's how lame it is. Please don't you say you're... An artist? He pushes his chest out. Maybe I am an artist. You hear that, everyone? I'm an artist now. Rhetoric says, did he just say I? Kuno usually calls Kuno, Kuno. Hold on, did I hear you right? You said I. Kuno made Kuno. Kuno says whatever the hell he wants. There are no rules here, pig. He steps closer. I say I when I wanna, and Kuno when I wanna. Kuno's free. Kuno's free to die. This is what he sometimes do when things get tense, Rhetoric says. Making art is a worthy calling. I'm something of an artist myself. Oh my god, Kuno! He's gonna make you totally lame in like 3 seconds. Don't let him, Kuno. Yo, screw you, see? Kuno can be what Kuno wants to be. Kuno's his own man. Kuno's free. He tears at the buttons of his shirt, trying to rip them open. They don't give way. Kuno made himself into Kuno. Kuno can make himself into anything. Kuno can make himself into a pig if he wants. Kuno can make himself into a... bleep. Even bleep that out. Kuno doesn't give a crap. Don't make yourself into a pig, Kuno. You'll have to take me away. A leaden silence fills the yard. That depends on the choices you make, young girl. Without a word, she disappears entirely behind the fence. Wow. For once, the boy is lost for words. He's turned completely red now, with splotches of white beginning to appear across his face. Authority says, use this momentary confusion to take control of the situation. Rhetoric says, you got him. Now convince him to leave the cryptozoologist traps alone. I need you to stop taking locusts from the traps. The cryptozoologists are trying to find something very important. Those locusts are bait. I don't give a crap. I don't need the locust anyway. It's all lame now. He runs toward the fence. She was right. The girl's face appears again above the fence, just long enough to make eye contact with Kuno. Conceptualization says she doesn't know whether to be glad because Kuno's finally convinced of the lameness, or more worried because of his continued use of the first-person singular. Kuno is Kuno, not I. Oh yeah, I don't realize he says it again. What's going to happen to the locusts? Kuno's going to let the locusts die. I have to ask, what does the city of locusts mean? It don't mean anything. It's crap. Kuno just likes to focus. Kuno just likes to concentrate on stuff, build stuff when he's zipping hard. He turns his face up to the heavens. Pig, he says finally, lowering his gaze to meet yours. You really shouldn't have screwed with Kuno's city. Now it's all lame. All right, now that that's settled, I better be off. The hell are they trying to catch, anyway? He asks before you leave. With the traps. The Insulindian phasmid. Huh? He mutters to himself. Redrick says he recognizes the name. Wait, do you know what the Insulindian phasmid is? Bitches think Kuno doesn't know crap, he says angrily. Hell out of here, Kuno's tired of this crap. There's silence between the two children, Redrick empathy says, rather. They're not saying anything to each other, nor looking in each other's direction. I talk to her with running without running all the way around.
I'll die before I squeal, pig!
She hides behind the fence. Child, converse with me.
Murder was the case. Was the case they gave me.
She has almost vanished behind the fence. Only the top of her hat remains.
I'll die before I squeal, pig.
Listen, child, that corpse made me puke twice, and I was wondering why you don't.
Stay away from me, pig! You don't want to see what happens when you corner me.
Oh, no.
I'll die before I squeal, pig. What is this kid shit? Fucking mind games! I'd rather die than squeal.
Get the fuck out of here, face! You got something! Talk to me!
Don't tell me what to do. Harry doesn't care. Alright, let's return to these guys. Missing insects case. Report your findings. The cryptozoologist Kuno has promised to stop. It's like 11 now. So is this other guy gonna be gone? Gary? Yep, he's gone. Where'd she go? Are they all left? I guess it's too late. They went to bed. Well, what's her name should be back. Yeah, even these guys left. The Hardys. We can try this again? Maybe? Can't even try. Alright, should we try this guy's apartment? It might be too late. What's that again? I don't remember that. Oh. Wait, did I see something else? I thought I saw something by the bench. Never mind. Anything new with her?
Give me a moment.
No. Oh. I keep finding new stuff. I thought those were boots. Alright, I thought there was money in the boots. Look at that, we got 20 real. Getting rich over here. I think we go up to the balcony. Oh, here he is! That guy.
Gendarmerie, you found me.
The young man on the balcony gives you a bright smile before taking another drag from his cigarette. Conceptualization says his slender figure is backlit by city lights, its distant streets and motorways flashing like diamonds. Empathy says, it feels like a Friday. He seems to be in a good mood tonight. We got your hint. Found the key right under that stone.
Beautiful.
He replies, smiling. As he looks at you, something sparkles in his eyes.
So tell me, are you here to make things right again?
That's what I'm aiming for, yes.
Beautiful.
He says again. A nearby street lamp casts shadows on his chin, drawing out the slender cheekbones.
I have some good news for you. My Sunday friend is visiting me tonight. I told him about you, and he'd like to say hello. Step in. He's already waiting.
He nods towards door number 28. Why would I want to meet your friend? Trust me, you do. By the way, I'm really digging the view here. That's why I chose this place. He looks away, his cigarette end glowing in the dark. Martinez is special, isn't it? Wait, suddenly you're digging things? Lieutenant whispers to you, shaking his head. Is it Friday tonight? It feels like Friday. Yeah, it does feel like the end of the week. Such gentle weather. Very well, I'll talk to him, but first I want to talk to you. I have so many questions. That's nice, but I don't have anything to tell you. It's my friend you're looking for, not me. He takes another drag of his unfiltered cigarette and looks around. It's getting dark, and the neighboring windows have lit up one by one. Besides, I've got to run. Inland Empire says he's going to leave you alone again. That's sad. But I just found you again. Just look at it. He gestures towards distant motorways, all leading to Golden La Delta. It's a beautiful night. Who's going to stay in on a night like this? Only if you promise that we'll talk again. It's important. Something flutters in the corner of the lieutenant's mouth as you're saying those words. We'll talk, the smoker assures you, brushing his hand through the hair. Just not tonight. That was weird. Interview the Sunday friend. Got a lot of experience for that. Take care, right? He says with another disarming smile before slipping off into the night. Conceptualization says, and he's gone again. Looks like it's becoming a theme for him. There's something so different about him that I can't just put my finger on. Different, of course. Oh my god, is he an ex or something? Why is his shirt always unbuttoned? His shirt. The lieutenant squints his eyes, trying to hold back laughter. His shirt. His shirt. Drama says he's trying to dive deep into the memories of his shirt. His shirt. No, I don't know why his shirt is always unbuttoned. His mouth tightens as though trying to hold something back. Come on, detective, let's go. We've got a potential witness to interview. His Sunday friend, remember? He nods at the apartment door before you. I don't know. This is weird. You finally met up with the mysterious smoker on the balcony. He said the one you really want to talk to is his friend. The friend is waiting for you inside in apartment 28. Go and meet him right now. He won't be there later. Okay. I just got a weird feeling about this. Who the hell is this? Someone we haven't met before? Oh, there's a lot of stuff going on. No, I don't know who that is. Let's look around first. An old photo of the same apartment, dated year 01. Governmental issues take me all over Revachol, as you can see. Buckets of paint on a layer of old newspapers. An exquisite canopy bed made of metal. Someone is always watching. A quarterly business magazine. Dishes soaked up in a pot. An empty ashtray. None of this is weird. Flyers for underground parties. Samarin conical hat. If stability is ensured, progress will naturally follow. This tawny cone-shaped hat looks like a beacon of Samarin wisdom. its straws sticking up like antennas. Thank God you can't really see people's reactions when they see you strolling around in this incredibly insensitive headpiece. Plus one for logic, for super logical for a cop to wear this, and minus one suggestion for insensitive bachelor party vibes. Alright then. Transparency has always been our highest quality. What's in here? All of this is perfectly normal, but mundane of everything, if anything. Party dragon silk robe. Plus one drama. Become the dragon. Plus one electrochemistry. Become an addict in a strange bathing robe. This sleazy, silky bathing robe in vibrant blues features a roaring dragon on its front, ready to take off into the night. A red belt has been provided for fastening. It's culturally insensitive, but only for people who aren't from Seoul. The real Seoulites probably don't care. Alright. Who's this? Moderacy in everything, even in moderacy. That's a lot of moderacy.
Officers of the Revachol Citizens Militia.
The man in business casual removes his cufflinks. Authority says you shouldn't be seeing him in an intimate setting. For some reason, you feel this man is your superior. Esprit de Corps says superior, but he's not in the command chain.
My name is Charles Villedron. I am an official with the coalition government. I work for the Institute of Price Stability on assignment from Sir Leclerc. I heard you talking to my friend outside. Very good, super. I'm here to assist you in any way possible. Ask me about the hanging.
Conceptualization says, hanging? What a drag. He seems like a cultured gentleman. You should ask him about the finer things. Okay, why not? Oh, we'll go with conceptualization. Before we go on, I absolutely have to inquire about this wonderful canopy.
Oh yes, my friend has a great eye for these things. He refuses to tell me where it came from. It's a mystery. I believe they call this type of frame industrial. It's very comfy. That's really all I can tell you about it.
He forms a little rooftop with his fingers. Cold air sweeps in from the balcony. The lieutenant takes out his notebook and nods to you to proceed. What's an official like you doing in Martinez? The coalition is only looking out for the price stability. He raises an index finger. Inflation is a killer, like a heart disease, blocking the normal circulation of the economy. It must be controlled. The economy impacts the entire international community, which is why it requires international oversight. What is the price stability? It is the most important thing. That doesn't tell me anything. It is the central goal of any sound monetary policy. Maintaining the price stability is essential for maintaining high levels of economic activity, which is essential for maintaining high levels of employment, which is essential for maintaining the social stability. Kim says, basically it makes sure the price of bread doesn't change. Precise amount. Too much inflation, bread becomes too expensive. Too much deflation becomes too cheap for bakers to produce. That's why the Institute of Price Stability works to keep inflation just below 2%. Below 2% of what? But not too far below, no. Too below is also bad. Below. But close to 2%. You're not answering my questions at all. The Coalition believes in the importance of informing the public about the business of, or benefits of, the price stability. Transparency is one of our principles. Would you like an informational pamphlet? Alright, sure, give me a leaflet. A sound monetary policy is essential for addressing uncertainty. Stability is the raison d'être. I think is how you say it. Raison d'être. Of the moral in turn. It is the reason why I identify as a moralist. He pats his pockets. But oh, I don't have my leaflets on me today. That's too bad. You can always call our information line. Making information available is part of the moral in turn's commitment to transparency. What is this international community? La Communauté Internationale is what Revacholians colloquially call the Coalition. In other words, the nations that stopped the disaster of the revolution. And what do I call the Coalition? Your employer, technically speaking, the governing authority of Revachol, the RCM is but one part of this provisional administration. So you're some kind of bureaucrat. Yes, as I said before, I'm a commissioner from Sur-la-Clef, working for the Institute of Price Stability. He glances at his watch. This is one of the main projects of the moral intern. Encyclopedia says, wait, there isn't actually an Institute of Price Stability, is there? Or maybe there is. God, it's impossible to understand whether someone from the moral intern is joking or not. I've heard about this moral intern before, but I want to know more. It's the International Organization for Moralists, hence Moralist International. The Institute of Price Stability is, well, I spelled it differently, is just one of the many mind babies, as is the coalition. Ooh, turn to Kim. So we're actually working for the moral intern? That doesn't seem so bad. Kim nods. There are more nefarious powers to work for than the moral intern. Oh, so the guy's name is Thomas now. Oh, you gave it away. All I knew was Sunday Friend until now. Turn back to Thomas, or Tomas. Are you a moralist? But of course. But why? Because moralists believe in a normal, stable world governed by democratic values. Lieutenant, are you a moralist? Me? I'm a lieutenant of the RCM, dedicated to maintaining law and order in Revachol. A very moralist answer, the man nods. Esprit de Corps says, the lieutenant is practicing the art of putting on a show for one's superiors. But what is a normal, stable world? The Occident is part of the normal world. Aurignier, Sur-la-Clef. Martinez doesn't seem very normal, or stable, to me. Martinez? No, Martinez is something else. What about the rest of Revachol? Is it part of the normal world? Revachol is generally difficult. Is led by an interim government, which means it hasn't yet achieved full democracy. But they are working towards it. You're all doing very well here, relatively speaking. He gives you an approving nod. Option D. It's like every time I'm talking to people, I'm choosing option D, none of the above. Is that moralism? Is this option D usually the most reasonable answer? Yes, everything else is super extreme. It's like I'm living with a bunch of lunatics. Sounds like you're a moralist indeed, my friend. Welcome. Moralism is all about compromise and achieving the achievable. It's pragmatic, realistic, and level-headed. An ideology for doers. Are you a doer, my friend? It looks to me like you are. Now, enough of this delightful political interlude. Is there anything else you wanted to ask? Tell me about Sur-la-Clef. What's there to say? Sur-la-Clef is a modern, urbanized country that measures very high on the Human Development and Freedom Index. Mostly, though, it is known as the executive heart of EPIS. Moreover, as a great sponsor of less emerged countries, Revachol is only one of its many darlings whose progress it supports and cherishes. Rhetoric says darlings. That can't be an official designation. What makes Revachol Sur-la-Clef's darling? Because a great percentage of Revachol's culture hails from Sur-la-Clef. Its language, its people, its cuisine, even. Or at least in the downtown La Delta area. Tell me about Aurignier. Aurignier is an exemplary nation who, as a core member of EPIS, contributes 28% of our annual budget. Next to Sur-la-Clef, Aurignier is probably the most prominent member of the international community. Which one of them is more EPIS? As founding members, they are both very EPIS. Aurignier carries a lot of political weight, while Sur-la-Clef takes care of the business side of things. Sur-la-Clef hosts the headquarters of the major EPIS institutions. Okay, but outside of EPIS, what is Aurignier? Aurignier's economy is one of the most advanced in the world. It has successfully transitioned from heavy industry to advanced services, and generally acts as an engine for sustainable change in the international community. Rhetoric says, but that didn't tell you anything about Aurignier. Can't you just talk like a normal person? About what? About Aurignier. Just tell me what it's like there. Oh, it's very urban and very well organized. Their streets are clean. Their horse cars run on time. Like I said, they're an example. Oh, wait. The people are polite and efficient. Like I said, they're an example for less emerged nations to follow. Okay, but what are you doing here in this apartment, getting back to things? Ah, well, I'm renovating it. It's a very interesting project. The building used to be a 12-story sized skyscraper before the cannons took the top four stories off. This, of course, happened when the coalition forces landed here. He smiles. You could say I'm undoing some of the material damage the international community caused when we arrived here. All right, enough business. Let's talk about something else. Whatever you wish, officer. Can you tell me about your friend? Ah, my friend. My friend is a good young man. His family immigrated here from Kedra, and life has not been easy for him. But he understands the importance of education. He has taken his future into his own hands, and that's all that matters. You still haven't told me who he is. Sorry, who? The man throws a quick glance at his watch. Your friend, the smoker on the balcony. We were just talking about him. But I told you, officer, he is a bright young man here to pursue his education. Education is the foundation of our future. Especially the arts is a cornerstone of our civilization. Fine, but what's his real name? Officer, you have to understand. I can't give you his personal information. I'm sure you have your own methods and databases, right? Please don't put me in this situation. So all you can tell me about him is that he's here to study the arts? He's deeply enmeshed in the study of the fine arts, yes. Conceptualization says, as though you weren't envious enough of the boy as is. Which arts? He's a truly free spirit. He likes all the arts. Perhaps graphic design, printmaking, who knows. The world is open, wide, for a talented youth like him. What's Kedra? Kedra is a candidate member of EPIS, but between you and me, their potential membership is a more contentious issue. What do you mean? That's never going to happen. They entered negotiations in 21, and it's been pending ever since. What's this EPIS thing you keep talking about? It's a very special program designed by the Moral Interns to support certain Occidental nations, yeah. It began as a unified system of weights and measures, which proved to be a wild success. Nothing but kilograms and centimeters as far as the eye can see. Logic says, God, yes, sweet standardization, the backbone of rationality and commerce. It was such a wild success that we expanded it into an economic union for the processing of steel. Another success. And between you and me, the Moral Intern feels emboldened by this success, emboldened to take EPIS to the next level. Okay, but like, what does it stand for? Why, it stands for progress and stability, like the Moral Intern as a whole. No, what do the letters stand for? It's been such a wild, extraordinary success thus far. We are very excited to take it to the next level. You don't even hear the words I'm saying, do you? A supranational political alliance, the United States of Occident. It still isn't. Is it going to be like this place here? You mean Revachol? No, it's going to have transparent democracy. Is Revachol going to be part of EPIS? It's one day going to be a candidate member of EPIS, sure. Rhetoric says, except that candidate members never become full members, do they? Didn't you say that candidate members never become real members? No, no. Candidate members do become members. Why do we even have the whole system in place if they don't? It just takes time. Time and evaluation. But we're talking about my friend here, not politics. How did you two even become friends? How did any of us become friends? Bad things happening on the Insulindian Isola? Oil platforms ablaze in the night? Civil wars lasting for years? Finally, the international community is forced to step in. What are you talking about? No one becomes friends that way. Au contraire. It's how millions of people end up where they are, meeting the people they meet. It's how I came here, and how my friend, too. What are you doing in his apartment by yourself? I'm just enjoying the view, the man smiles, nodding to the window. Enjoying the view, there's a dead body hanging in the tree. The lieutenant sighs. A dead body we still need to get down, by the way. Listen, he says, raising his hand. What? I'm not hearing anything. The Insulindian Bay. What about it? This place used to be a luxury accommodation before the revolution. Apartments, of course, were much bigger then. A few walls have been added here and there, leaving some of the tenants without a private bathroom or a kitchen. But the million real of you says, or the million real of you stays, you can't take that away. He knocks on the balcony door, his face mirrored in the darkened glass. I was asking about your friend. My friend comes and goes. I'm sure you'll see him around. He's a busy bee. A busy bee, Redrick says. What an odd choice of words. I had something else in mind. I'm all ears, officer. You actually witnessed a lynching? I'm sorry to say I did, officer. The man gives a solemn nod. Turn to the lieutenant. This is just the break we've been looking for. Easy, detective. No need to jump to conclusions. He eyes the spectacled man near the window, who smiles and spreads his hand. Alright, I'm not gonna just go out and say, of course we're not gonna get a... Like, yeah, I completely did it. Take me in. Start from the beginning, if you don't mind. Officer, it's very difficult to describe what I saw that night. It was so surreal to me, like in a play. Drama says he holds out his hands and blossoms his fingers like a drama teacher setting the scene. Indeed. The lieutenant is ready scribbling down notes. What do you mean, like in a play? It was just so strange. I could barely comprehend what was happening. I was on the balcony when it happened, getting some fresh air. I remember that first they came in, carrying what looked like a body, and then I saw all the surrounding windows go dead one by one. That's when I understood. I should not be seeing this. Kim says, sounds like the victim was unconscious, or at least incapacitated. Well done, detective. He nods to you. Who were they? Can you describe them? I couldn't see their faces well, and there were quite a few of them, but they were very loud and very... Martinese. He pauses, looking for the right wording. Let's just say that the laboring classes can get rather expressive with their profanities. How many of them were there? I couldn't tell you exactly. Less than 10? Maybe 8? I think 8 is the magic number. The lieutenant sends you a sharp look at the mention of that number. Were any of them huge? Like 200 kilograms huge? That's a giant you're describing. No, they were all quite human, so far as I could tell. What happened next? I went back inside. Kim says, were you able to see anything from inside? Officer, the yard was pitch black. There was nothing to see, but I could still hear their voices. They were threatening to kill the poor man. Were they men? Women? All men, I presume, but again, I couldn't see very clearly. What ethnicity were they? I believe they were mostly white, though I believe I saw two Areopagites among them, and I'm quite certain that one spoke with a Mesk accent. What happened next? Well, that's the strangest part, officer. Nothing happened. It was oddly quiet for a public lynching. What do you mean, nothing happened? They lynched a guy. Eventually, their shouts died down, and that was all. There were no gunshots, no celebratory shouts, no anything. Why didn't you call the RCM? The man wipes his glasses. You're right, of course. That is what one was supposed to do in such circumstances. I was simply in shock. I'm afraid I don't have anything else to add. Kim asks, about what time was this all happening, approximately? All I can say is that it was late. You didn't check your watch? I mean, you do it all the time now. My watch. He looks at his watch, as though noticing it for the first time. Yes, now I remember. It was 30 minutes past midnight, give or take. Oh, you remember that so all of a sudden. So let me get this straight. You didn't actually witness the hanging itself, did you? No, I didn't see the corpse until the following day. Kim says, it seems this wasn't the break you were hoping for. I think we have everything we need, the lieutenant says, closing his notebook. Thank you for talking to us, Mr. Villadrun. New skill point. Thanks. I've got all I need. A moment, officer. Do you have anything you need from me? I'm afraid we won't have the chance to speak again once you leave. Hold on. Why can't we talk later? It's against diplomatic best practices for an official in my position to be discussing murders with local militiamen. He pauses. And I'm pressed for time. After you leave, I should be leaving as well. Logic says that's not the real reason he's so apprehensive. Men in his position shouldn't be loitering around in an underprivileged young men's apartments in the middle of the night. I guess there's nothing else. Thanks for the heads up, but my work here is done. Of course. I'm sorry I couldn't be the prick you were looking for. Good luck with the investigation. So it's done. Pain threshold. Basically because I want to go up against Measurehead. I'll try anyway.
Was there anything else?
Look around again. Nothing else. Stability, yes. What's midnight?